Okay, thank you and welcome. So we will be talking today about machine learning. This is a concept that we figured out together with my colleague who is sitting here, Łukasz. And we thought about optimizing the processes in smart factories. So a little bit about me. So I'm working in IT for around 10 years. I'm coming from PGS Software. This is a software services company out of Poland. And I'm actually leading the data science team there. Together with my colleagues, we are working with different manufacturers, but also in other industries. So Industry 4.0, actually, I would like to thank Martin very much for a great presentation, which was a perfect introduction to what we want to show right here. So the main challenges of Industry 4.0 that we see talking with our customers is that it's actually no longer the question like if we are doing that, but when we are doing that. I worked a lot in Asia Pacific region, and the companies there are far advanced, and that's why we are sharing this concept together with you here, so that you could also benefit and take it away and implement it so that we are able to catch up. Also, the adoption of technology is growing, and it's quite difficult because it requires investment, and it's also hard to implement it on a, like a wider strategic level. There are many pilots happening, but in reality, out of pilots, you don't get a huge benefits. As Martin was showing, there is like a lot of money invested, but not a good return on it. So we are also addressing this. And the concept is around three key areas. First of them is connectivity. Because of course, if you want to have a smart factory and you don't want to build a data center below it, you need to use some processing power somewhere, and sending all of this data from cameras and from sensors to basically to the cloud or to some other data center provider. It's a lot. It's a lot of data, and it's hard to build up an infrastructure because it would be a huge investment. Also, the important part is the intelligence, because you don't build up all of these things just to have them and show off on some presentations, but actually to get some benefits. And here comes the machine learning part and different algorithms that can help you to optimize your production, and also, of course, flexibility to automate. So the solution cannot be just rigged and built straightforward to one goal, but rather to be able to optimize in different areas. So Deloitte also presented a really nice, where's the pointer? Okay, never mind. So the adoption levels of Industry 4.0, because the way the journey there could be split into four stages. First, you are putting some sensors into your IoT, into your production devices. You are putting some actuators and try to focus on a single piece of machinery, like a press or a furnace to bake steel or some like mixer. And then you go to the production line level, where you are focusing on optimizing like a full production line or full assembly line of a single component. And also there is a next level, which is the factory level, where you're trying to connect different production lines, but also the warehousing and the logistics, how the materials are coming in and how their quality is checked, and also the exit quality, so what kind of product is going out of the factory. And the important part is that there is also a level 4, which not many people talk about right now, and this is a factory network level. So assuming you have more plants or more production lines in one plant, you could actually see right now that these plants are competing between each other. So the best one of them is trying to show off that they have a higher volume of production or better quality, but this knowledge and insights are not shared, really. Or even if they are, you could write like an ECN, a change note, put it to HQ, and then it's propagated maybe sometimes after like 6 months or so, and we would like to have this process faster. So from what we see, in Europe, the single asset level is already achieved. Most of you guys are already investing there, and it's like 90% of the factories that we see are there. 10% is optimizing on the production line level. That's what we also saw. There are 3 or 4 touching the like a full smart factory, full-blown optimization, and these are usually the plants that are freshly built. And we have not seen yet this like a factory network level. So we wanted to share with you the technical insights how you could do it. The important part is that actually the main challenge is to have successful pilot projects, but not scoped locally, but on the entire organization level. So this kind of knowledge should be shared, because if you start implementing Industry 4.0 like in plant A and plant B, and they are not talking to each other, when you start doing this connected factory level, it will not happen, because everything there will be different. So the biggest challenges were already mentioned on the previous presentation, so I'll briefly go through it. First is the technology stack. We are coming from manufacturing industry. It's hard to have like a full IT team where there are people focused on cloud, on data science, on IoT, and to combine all of these competences together. And yeah, this is the main challenge that we see, the lack of people and lack of possibilities to build solutions in-house. Also, there is a problem with buying them off the shelf, because then you are locked into a single particular vendor. The security is one very important thing. So data shouldn't be exposed outside. That's a very important part. And the misuse of this data, or like exposing them to your competitors or to the general market, could be very harmful. So we are focusing a lot in this concept also on security. We have a customer in Germany, for example, coming to us, which was who was actually quite high, because it was on the factory optimization level. But the data were flowing in and out in the open, not encrypted. So even if you are focusing and you are far advanced in the Industry 4.0 and just automation, you shouldn't forget about security. Also, the operability is a very important part, because a production line is almost never coming from a single company. Like if you have a set of machines to produce some goods, and there are like 20 different machines, they very rarely or never come from one single manufacturer. So the important part is that the challenge that we observe is that different devices have different data formats. They store a temperature in a different way, one in Fahrenheit, one in Celsius, one store data in JSON, one store data in Excel. And if you try to connect all of this, it seemed really difficult. Also, the long-term vision, what we see, there is like a general lack of strategy. Where do you want to go? Because assuming that Industry 4.0 realized fully would be this fourth level. And if you start doing pilots on a single machine or single production line level without any strategy in mind, you could then later on be very surprised and not being able to jump into level 3 or level 4. So basically, there is like a pilot purgatory, as the McKinsey guy called it. So we see that there are many pilots started, different companies coming in and trying to do a pilot on a small scale level, level 1 or level 2. And we are not really seeing any kind of meaningful results out of it, because in order to have a real return on investment in terms of money, you need to focus wider on a full process, at least on the full factory level, and even better on the company level. Because it's really hard if you have like an old production line and everything is fully manual, and there are two or three machines automated. This is not bringing you enough benefits to say that it was worth it doing that. So coming to the solution, like what is the key to fully enabled Industry 4.0? In my experience, is basically this mesh twin learning and micro optimizations. There are a lot of works from statisticians from late 50s. And based on the Taguchi's work, we saw that the best way to optimize the processes is by micro optimizations. I will explain it later, but just wanted to mention it, that this is based on the papers coming from the earlier times. But the technology that makes it possible and allows to build this kind of solutions is quite new. It's coming from like beginning of this year. So there are not many people like already being far ahead of you. And if you start today, you can still be on the same level with your competition. Also, the concept touches this Industry 4.0 requirement. So basically the security, the strategic alignment. And the funny story is how this was actually made up. We were sitting on a coffee with my colleague. We had a problem from one of our customers where they were saying that, yeah, we would like to do the optimization, but please tell us where we are going, how this would look like in 3 years. And we started thinking about it. And it was exactly the same time where there was a like AWS competition, this Amazon Cloud. They were showing the automated cars competition. So basically, you could build a machine learning model who would do self-driving cars, and you then send these models to Amazon and compete with other players from all around the world. So we won this competition, and our number one is PGS. And we figured out that, yeah, it would be nice to do it on much bigger scale. So these kind of models could be sent and competing with each other, which I will show in the MTL concept. So the concept itself touches the whole circle of data analysis. So first, this is about creating and updating the records. So this is the digital twin part. All the machinery and all of the sensors are represented in the cloud as a like programmatic representation of the device, which holds its actual current state and also the history of it, from which it could learn. There is the analyze and assess phase, where there are machine learning models and predictive models which are looking into and trying to optimize the solution, but also give you the best and possible insights out of the vast amount of data. And there is a translation into action, so sending commands to all of the actuators and the production lines to improve something. So the concept works like this. The first phase is local modeling. So on the production line, you have your edge device, where inside this device, there is a light machine learning model running. So you may imagine that if you have your IoT gateway, it's a very small computer inside, like a Raspberry Pi or something like that. And we figured out a way to run the machine learning models, which are, have a smaller footprint and are localized to a single and particular problem. These LightML models from the factory are then exported and sent to the digital twin of the device in the cloud. This is really important because instead of sending the vast amount of data, which will come later and go in batches, so it's not like that it will be lost, but what's happening in the real time is that exported models are sent to the twin, and that's it. So this has a very small footprint, and the size of such package of an exported model is just like a single email, so you can send it even over the phone. You don't need to like have redundant fiber channel connection to do it. So the last phase of it and the biggest benefit is if you have more plants or more production lines, because these models are then sent into one and central location. So each connected factory is putting it into the set of digital twins and simulations, and the models are competing with each other. So you may imagine that if you have like three or four factories and one model wins, it's propagated down to all of them. And if you have one factory producing you a higher output and better quality, others are right here. Just after sending these models, they are growing up, and all your factories are as good as your best one, which is definitely something that you would like to achieve. So now going to the practicalities, because the concept is nice on the pictures, but let's focus on the real implementation, like how to do it. So first, we are applying machine learning on four different levels of the digital twins. There is a component twin, which is focused on a single component. Like you may imagine that you have a quality check camera or a thermal imaging sensor to check the quality of the goods that you are producing. You could adjust the speed and temperature of a single device. Also, this is the level where all the alerting is coming. So like something is broken with a device or the predictive maintenance algorithm knows that some parts should be exchanged. It will let you know here. There is also an asset level twin, which is a parameter optimization for, you could imagine, like a single production nest. So if you have a nest where you are taking a steel and baking it, then you have parameters to optimize like a furnace temperature, like a pressure, the time that the steel is there being baked. And also there you could make much better optimizations because you are not controlling a single parameter, but a piece of the process. And if you are going to the full process level, then you have a process twin. So this is a place where you could put up the optimizations on the level of the full production line. Like if you want to optimize the ecological footprint, the amount of energy that is being used, or the amount of ingredients to limit waste, this is the process level twin. And last but not least is a system twin. This is the most important one for the factory mesh concept, because there actually you have the full set of process twins, asset twins, and component twins connected all together. And there you can do the automation of your like entire company. So how it's being built, here is a simple example with AWS, but this could be built with any cloud provider. We have also experience and be partners of Microsoft Azure, of Google Cloud Platform, and also building systems on-premise on the customer hardware if they have a data center. So the idea how you do it and the services that makes it possible, first of all, this is IoT Greengrass or other services that allow you to control the IoT devices. So this is a way to update their firmware, to manage the devices, to send the models which are created in the cloud and which are then optimized. And about the optimization, that goes the next component, which is called AWS SageMaker Neo. What happens with that is that if you have a full processing power of the cloud, like unlimited numbers of CPUs and memory, and they are producing a model which is working for a particular device, what this can do, it can export this model in a format that is optimized for this piece of machinery. So if you have a, like a robotic arm which is doing a measurement, you will get a model that is, has a much less memory footprint, it's smaller, and it's, the code is being compiled just for this machine. And the benefit is that we see and we observed implementing it that there is no loss in the accuracy. So the accuracy of that model, which is optimized for the particular device, is exactly the same as the big one in the cloud. And also, of course, there is the AWS SageMaker, so the component that resides in the cloud and controls all of this and builds these models. So the technical challenges that are being solved by MTL concept is that we are, first of all, much more efficient than in a standard way, because we are not sharing this huge amount of data, we are sharing the models and exporting that. Also, the solution is not dependent on a particular IoT vendor or a machine, because data is not what's the key concept here, but other DML models. So you may imagine that if out of your prediction, it seems that you need to raise gradually and slowly the temperature, this is the insight that is being provided to the central place. You are not providing a set of data in a strange and different formats which you cannot compare, but rather insights. Also, the ML models competition is very important here, because this is the way how you can achieve synergies between your factories and different plants, even if they are not now very willing to cooperate together and share their ideas. So here, this sharing is happening automatically and cycle is very fast. So the power and benefits of mesh twin learning comes to the process optimization. Here you have a very simple example. You may imagine that you are like baking a cake and you have amount of flour and water to build up a dough. So the important part is that there is always a one and single sweet spot, the amount of two ingredients that are going together, which will help you to maximize the output and bake most of the cakes. This is like a two-parameter optimization of one production output. It looks already quite complicated. A normal production processes that we see have around 10,000 to 30,000, like a full process, the amount of parameters. So now imagine this graph in 10,000 dimensions. It would be very hard to do it in a human way on the piece of paper. So how it's being done inside the algorithm, it's that you have a set of inputs which are adjustable, which you can control. This is this amount of ingredients, this is the temperature of the process, the speed of some actuators or a voltage. And there is a set of course, of uncontrolled inputs, at least usually, so the material characteristics, if you get materials coming from your suppliers, this is what it is, you can just measure it and put it as an input data to the process. Also, there is a set of ambient conditions like temperature, like the humidity and different things that like are environment in your factory, which are also heavily influencing some processes, but you usually don't have much control over it, unless you have like a parade on the red square and you move the clouds away, but normally you don't do that. So the outputs and outcomes, there are different things that you could calculate and measure to optimize, because your optimizations will not give you a benefit in all of these areas. You could either have the optimizations being done for higher quality or higher production rate or higher efficiency, not all of them at once. And if you choose one of the outputs and outcomes that you want to have, then you take this one of these adjustable inputs in one factory and in one production line, and you do a very small change, like plus 0.1 Celsius degrees on the temperature on one production nest. In the other factory, you can also do an experiment at a voltage, like plus 2 millivolts to some galvanization process just to see if it works. And if you have this kind of experimentation done and this fast cycle, in 10 minutes you will get an info how it influences an output. If the influence is positive, it's added as an insight and propagated across all the production lines and all the factories. If it's not beneficial, then it's reverted and the next thing is being tried. Of course, we are not trying randomly. There are algorithms that are based on the historical data, are choosing the step and the parameter which is worthwhile, at least predictively. But after this kind of 10-minute iteration cycles, in a week or two, you will get a sweet spot optimizing all the production process parameters to a target thing. And if you, after like 3 months, get from your boss a new info that, hey, now we don't want to produce more but better quality, you just change the goal of the optimization, the process goes over back again automatically, just focusing on a different output. So coming back to the adoption level, so definitely the machine learning is a concept which will allow you to go directly to the level 4 and have the full technical capabilities built in order to have it without the huge investments. So use cases that could be run are like fairly standard ones, like production optimization, maintenance, and automated QA. This is something that everyone is doing. The ones that are important for me personally is the energy usage optimization, which we saw great benefits in Korea, for example, by reducing the energy footprint by 10%. It doesn't seem much, but if you calculate it into money, it's really nice. And also the operator augmentation. We are not forgetting people in this equation. So whenever you have a manual part of the production process, you could build a mobile app using augmented reality, for example, to give the instructions to the operator. So if you see from this microprocess optimization that speed of the process should be increased, on the tablet of your operator, it could show that, yeah, turn the knob right a little bit to speed up the process and observe the results and put a feedback in. Of course, this data is then not perfect. It could bear a human error, but still is not excluding anyone out of it. So where to start with machine learning? If you want to implement it for yourself, you need to do an assessment of your current infrastructure, what kind of devices you have, and what is available, what data and what models could be run. Then you try to identify a low-hanging fruit to implement the concept itself. Like in the case that we had last year, was a thermal imaging camera on the final QA inspection. There was a like a metal product, and it was doing an inspection if there are not any cracks or problems with the bonding. So then this is built up for 3 production lines in order to achieve the scale benefit and be able to experiment on a wider scale, and then you are ready to grow. It may seem like a complex thing, but in reality, this process is around 100 real working days, of course, not a calendar days, but working. And so we saw that extension of this time is mostly the like getting an access to the factory floor or getting some network connectivity and not really like the technical thing that is behind it. So just to finish up, the outcomes of the MTL is that you have like a unified strategy for this Industry 4.0 and how to go to level 4 in details. You get a swarm intelligence, so all of your assets are working together for the benefit of the company, not like against each other. And you get a competitive advantage because it's quite fresh and new and there are not many companies doing it like for 10 years already and you are behind. So let's get in touch later on if you are interested in the concept, and now I'm open for any questions that you could have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mazur, for explaining to us what mesh twin learning means. Any questions from your side? Otherwise, I would be interested on what is the critical mass of participants in the mesh. You said you need to start with a few production lines, or you can scale up to several factories. How many single units would I need for a first start in order to create the first mesh and in order to benefit from the information I get from that mesh?
Okay, so as the first start that we are doing, we are usually approaching a single plant or a single factory, and we are doing it on the one shop floor, but different production lines, at least 3 of them to make sense of the exporting the model and connecting them between each other. There was only one case that some company came and have like 2 factories which you connect in the beginning. But usually we start at one with different production lines and different assets that are there.
Okay, so at least 3 which are similar or best case identical from product side, then this would be a good start into a first mesh.
Yes, and even if they are not identical from the product side, important is that they are producing the same goods and the same process. Of course, you cannot have models communicating with each other from like a production of a steel and plastic elements, because it doesn't make any sense.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Maciej.